So thank you very much for the invitation to speak here. It's really an honour to participate in such an ancient ritual. I should say that I hope you will forgive my New Zealandness, and I should admit that I had to leave New Zealand because I had no interest in sport whatsoever. It's very difficult to survive on that side. So I came over here and I'm hiding away in my lab. So don't worry about ignoring me. But what I'd like to do is to tell you a little bit, not so much about my own specific research, but about the background in which my research sits, which is part of this ongoing project that's been going on for well over 100 years now to understand one of the most amazing mysteries of the mind, which is how it creates this kind of universe inside itself and stores and remembers things that have happened. So how are memories formed? How is it that you can retrieve a memory without having to sit there and leaf through pages and pages of your mental book to find something? You can just reach it and immediately find it. We still have no idea how this is really done, but we've made a lot of progress, and I want to tell you about that. So it turns out that memory is very closely linked in our brains with our sense of space, and this is something that took a little while for psychology to fully appreciate, but actually we've known about it in a more general way for a very, very long time. So back in ancient times, it was known that you could use space as a way to help organize your memories. And the ancient Greeks and Romans, if they had a speech to deliver, instead of having their PowerPoints with their lists of notes and things, they had to remember an hour or two or 3 hours of speech. And what they did is that they would create a mental map of some place that's very familiar to them, like their homes or the town that they lived or something. And they would imagine walking through that place, and in various places around that space, they would put the things they needed to remember. So they created a mental image of each item that they wanted to talk about in their speech, and they put it mentally in this place. And then as the speech unwound, they would imagine walking through this place, and they would remember by seeing in their mind's eye what thing was where. And in that way, they were able to remember enormous amounts of material. And in fact, modern-day memory, mnemonists and so on, they use the same method of loci. So we've known for a long time that space and memory are somewhat linked. But it turns out that actually they are extremely interwoven in the brain. Psychologists started to think about memory at the end of the 19th century, and William James, who is often called the father of psychology, had some very, very far-reaching things to say about memory. And he had this intuition that memory was something to do with connections between the brain and the mind. So he wrote this incredible book about psychology, and in it there's this passage: memory being altogether conditioned on the ability to excite brain paths, its excellence in a given individual will depend partly on the number and partly on the persistence of these paths. So he had this intuition that there was that information somehow flowed through the brain, and I think of it as a bit like water flowing down a sandbank or something like that, carving out channels, and then if you pour water again, it will tend to follow those same paths. So his intuition was that memory involves paths, connections between representations in the brain, and that a stronger memory will be a deeper path, a more persistent path. And that's an idea that's turned out to be very, very true, as far as we can tell, now that we understand a lot more about the physiology of what's going on. So the formal study of how memories are formed in the brain was really initiated by Pavlov, who was a gastric physiologist to begin with. He was interested in salivation in dogs, the mechanisms of it, the physiology of it. And he developed this mechanism for studying salivation in dogs. So he would have the animals, can you see the pointer? He would have these dogs sit in a harness and a bowl in front of the dog, and he would present the dog with food, and the dog would salivate, and he would collect the saliva and measure it, and so on and so on. And he kind of found that when he presented food, there was a very predictable rise in the increase in saliva. And then eventually he found that the dog started salivating before the food was presented. It seemed to recognize the sounds of the food being prepared. And he realized that whatever mechanisms or other are generating saliva were learning about the sounds of food preparation and attaching themselves to that instead. And he realized that this was a method for studying memory formation. And he proposed that memory is formed from connections new connections be created between these new stimuli, for example, the rattling sound of the bowl, then the natural world wouldn't be associated with food, but in this particular situation are associated with food. So he basically proposed that all memory is formed from these stimulus associations or stimulus response associations, these very, very simple connections between things. And he formalized it down here in words that we still use today. So the conditioned stimulus is the thing that the animal learned about. The unconditioned stimulus is the thing that normally produces a response, like food in that case. And the conditioned response is the learned response. And that method became the method of study for the next century. In fact, we still use this method, so it's still really commonly used, the formation of associations between stimuli and responses, or stimuli and other stimuli. So we realise now that memory can be formed from very, very complex connections between these things. But he really gave us a method for asking these questions that we didn't have before. And he won the Nobel Prize in, I think, 1904 or something, for his work on memory. So that kicked off this neurobiological inquiry about where in the brain were these connections being formed, these paths, as James called them, all these stimulus associations, where were they? So Lashley was a neurobiologist who developed methods for trying to find where these memory traces were. And these memory traces were called the engram, and he felt it should be possible to find out where it is in the brain. So you rattle a bowl and the dog salivates. So somewhere between the nerves that are generating the saliva and the ear, somewhere in that pathway, there's got to be this new connection that's formed. And if you make a disconnection somewhere in the brain in that pathway, then you should be able to abolish that conditioned response. And he spent years and years and years trying to do these experiments. And this picture shows you, as kind of a summary picture of all of the various lesions that he made, that sort of cuts that he made in the brain. So this is the brain. This is the brain of a dog, I think, looking down from the top and looking from the side. And each of those lines is an experiment that he did, making what he was trying to, make a disconnection. And as you can see, he made a lot of experiments, a lot of disconnections, and never really managed to abolish the conditioned response in dogs. And he wrote, and he kind of summed up his work in this sort of monograph in the 1940s. He said, "I sometimes feel, reviewing the evidence on the localization of the memory trace, that the necessary conclusion is that learning just is not possible." So it just seemed like it was really resistant to damage. But what he did find, actually, that turned out to be quite important, is that he could somewhat degrade memory if he made enough damage. So the more of the cortex, the outer part of the brain, the more of that was damaged, the worse the animal's behavior got. But he never really managed to be just obliterated in a simple way that he thought. So that suggested that maybe memory wasn't just in a path, but maybe it was distributed across quite wide regions of the brain, and that's why no one of these experiments was able to have this effect. So picking up on this idea, people started to think about this possibility that memory might be distributed across a wide variety of brain tissue. And one of the people who was really, really foresighted in thinking about this is Donald Hebb, who was a neuropsychologist working in McGill in Canada. And he wrote this book in the 1940s called The Organization of Behavior, which laid out in this really beautiful way his ideas about how knowledge might be organized in the brain. And so he's thinking now not just about these simple stimulus responses, but actually more complex ideas, concepts, and so on and so on. And he came up with this idea that he called the self-assembly, which is basically that if you activate in your mind some concept or other, let's say you think of a cat, then some number of neurons in your brain become active simultaneously. And he called this simultaneously active group of neurons a self-assembly. And the idea that he was trying to articulate is that knowledge is formed by these cell assemblies which get constructed on the basis of your experience. And when you retrieve them, somebody shows you a drawing and that makes you think of a cat, that activates that cell assembly and those neurons become active together. So what this picture is showing is a kind of a cartoon of a bunch of neurons, and red ones are showing the active ones. And the idea that he had, which was really simple in retrospect, but really profound and has had enormous influence, is that at the beginning, when you first encounter, let's say you first encounter a cat, you're a baby, you first encounter a cat, then there aren't, there's nothing special about the connections between these neurons. So a bunch of neurons come active. Let's say, for example, that there are neurons that respond when you see pointy ears, and there are neurons that respond when you see fur, and so on. A whole bunch of these neurons get activated altogether when you see your first cat. And his intuition was that the simultaneous activity of these neurons should cause the connections between them to get stronger, so that the next time something activates some of those neurons, because of those strong connections, then it'll activate all the rest of them, and the whole assembly will spring into life. So somebody shows you a pointy ear and a bit of fur, and you get a cat, you know. So you've reactivated that cell assembly. And so his idea was that synchronous activity between neurons should cause connections between them to become stronger. And we now call that the Hebb rule, and it forms the basis of almost every neural network model of thinking, and you know, all of the stuff that's coming along now, DeepMind and AI and all of that stuff. It's all fundamentally based on the Hebb rule, this idea that connections form and strengthen between synchronously active elements of your representation that you're trying to form. Now, neurons that participate in a cell assembly may also participate in a different cell assembly. So when you see a dog, some of the same neurons that when you see the dog will become active as when you think of a cat or see a cat. So not only are these concepts distributed across the brain, but they share some of the substrates. So really, when you're thinking of a dog and you're thinking of a cat, what's different is the pattern of activation of neurons in your brain, as well as which neurons are active. So the basic take-home message is that memories are therefore distributed across the entire brain, and that of course means that it's really, really difficult for neuroscientists to study them, because how are you going to go about testing memory in the way that Blashie was trying to do, if it's distributed across the brain? You know, how are you going to reach in and pull out a cell assembly for a cat? It just seems to be incredibly impossible. And we also have a scale problem. So if you look into the brain, you see lots and lots of neurons. They're very, very tiny. Here's a micrograph of neurons. Each one of these little blobs is smaller than a hair, so they're really tiny. And we have lots and lots of them. So I Googled it quickly, and it seems to be around about 100 million, it will take a few tens of millions in the human brain. So there are lots and lots and lots. And when you think of the number of connections, so each neuron has maybe thousands and thousands of places on its branches that can connect to other neurons. So the number of connections between neurons is more than the number of particles in the universe or something like that. It's a very, very large number. Not only that, but even just the connections between regions of the brain are really multitudinous. So this is a very famous type of diagram by David Van Essen, who's a neuroanatomist. And he's spent most of his career tracing which parts of the brain are connected to which other parts of the brain. And it looks like pretty much every part of the brain is connected to every other part of the brain. So this is a little fragment of the visual system. I know we have a lot of visual neuroscientists in the audience. And this is just the visual cortex. And this is just some regions of it, and you can see every one of those lines is a connection between one bit and one other bit. So again, we have this huge scale problem when we're trying to understand how this all works. Okay, so that was the sort of 1940s, memory distributed throughout the brain. And the thinking was really that the memory was not really dependent on any one particular structure. But that picture began to change as a result of a very important event in the 1950s. Which was this this neuropsychological case which came to public attention. And this is the story of H.M., who is one of the most famous neuropsychological patients of all time. And he was a young man, so this picture's from various times of his life. He lived until his 80s. And as a young man, he had really terrible epilepsy, temporal lobe epilepsy, which is epilepsy which starts deep in the temporal lobes at the side of the brain. And what happens is that a seizure will start in that part of the brain, people will feel a bit weird and they'll start to hallucinate. And then the seizure will spread right across the brain and they'll have a full blown, one mile seizure and they'll fall to the floor, twitching and frothing, and they lose consciousness and they lose control of their bladder and bowel and sometimes can die, but not usually. But it's very debilitating, obviously. And he was having many of these seizures in a day. And it was completely incapacitated. He had to quit his job and came to the neurosurgeon William Scovell and despair and said, can you help me? And Scovell did some tests and discovered that he had a focus for the seizures. So it's at the beginning of the seizure, started on both sides of his brain, so in both temporal lobes. So neurosurgeons have found that in very severe temporal lobe epilepsy, you could remove a temporal lobe and seizures would never start. So basically they'd be cured. And also then people seem to be quite fine afterwards. So Scovell said to HM, look, we're going to do this procedure on you, but we're going to have to do it on both sides of the brain because you seem to have a focus on both sides. But you know, you'll be fine. I mean, it was a very serious operation, but actually Scovell had done it on a few patients by then, and people did seem to be fine, but the patients that he'd done it on were schizophrenic people who were very, very severely compromised in other areas of their lives anyway, so they seemed to be fine insofar as they didn't seem to be much different after this than even before. With HM, it was really different. It was immediately apparent that he had a very profound amnesia and couldn't remember anything that happened from that moment, from the moment that he woke up from the surgery, for the rest of his life. So he remembered pretty much all of his life up until that point, so he knew who he was and what his job was and where he lived and who his parents were. And, you know, basically, you could ask him all sorts of questions and he knew all about his past life. But he didn't remember that he met you 10 minutes previously and you'd been out get a coffee and come back in, you've completely forgotten it. So he could remember for as long as his attention was on something, but the moment his attention wandered off to something else, everything was gone. So it seemed that whatever surgery had done to him, it had destroyed a memory part of his brain. So Scovell teamed up with a neuropsychologist, Brenda Milner, and they studied HM, and in fact studied him for many decades afterwards. And they concluded that in the temporal lobe is a structure called the hippocampus, and they concluded that the hippocampus must be a memory structure of some sort. So this is a picture of the hippocampus. So this is HM, this is a schematic. This is the brain seen from underneath. And you can see that this is a normal brain, and these are the temporal lobes here on the sides. So they're kind of behind the ears and quite deep and low in the brain. And then this is where his surgery was, so he's just got gaps on where the temporal lobe should be. So it was quite a big procedure. And if you look at the cross-section of the brain, you can see that down here, so this is the cut that's been made parallel to the face. So this is the temporal lobe here, and this is the hippocampus here, and you can see that it's gone here. So the hippocampus is very large in the temporal lobe, and so Scovell and Miller concluded that hippocampus might be something to do with memory formation. So on one hand, we've got memory distributed throughout the brain, but on the other hand, we've got what looks like a structure that's important to memory. So what's going on with that? So it became very important for people to look at the hippocampus and try and understand what was going on. Now, it's quite deep in the brain, as I mentioned. This is it here. So this is the red is the hippocampus. This is kind of glass brain picture. If you dissect it out, an anatomist loves seeing patterns in what they find. And then seeing, what does this make me think of? So it activates some cell assembly in their brains. And for some reason, this can activate the hippocampus cell assembly in anatomist brains. So the hippocampus is a breed of seahorse. So that's why they named it hippocampus. So it does look remarkably like a seahorse, actually. So this is it here. Now, it became kind of imperative to try and understand what was going on in the hippocampus. And to really understand how a brain structure is working, you need to be able to actually go in and look at the neurons and find out what are the neurons doing, what are they saying to each other. So you need to be able to get electrodes into the brain and listen to the neurons. Now, how do we do this? Obviously, humans are somewhat resistant to having electrodes placed in their brains. Although, actually, quite a few humans do have electrodes in their brains, and that's turned out to be really useful. So these days, we still do this temporal lobe removal procedure to cure epilepsy. Nowadays, you do it just on one side of the brain, and it's still fine if you do it just on one side. But also, to try and minimize the damage, we try and identify the exact place where the focus is of the epilepsy. And to do that, they put electrodes into the brain. And so neuroscientists have capitalized on this, and we've been able to listen to the human hippocampus as well. But mostly we look at animals. So animal models have been tremendously important in neuroscience for all sorts of things. And the rat is the animal of choice because we know so much about rats, and they're small and they're easy to look after, and they're quite like humans in many ways. And we shouldn't be consulted by that. Rats are really smart. They're really friendly and very sociable. And they do all the things that we do, like they navigate around and they form memories and so on and so on. So the rat brain is a really, really good model of the human brain. And so we spend a lot of time studying it. This is the rat brain here. It's much smaller, obviously, because rats are small, but also it's simpler because it lacks the very folded cortex that the human brain has. But everything is still there. It's just smaller and a bit simpler. So if you look at the rat hippocampus in cross-section, it's got this really amazing structure. So this is a close-up micrograph of the hippocampus. So this is the cortex over the top here. So this is another one of these coronal sections that's been made parallel to the face. So the cortex is up here, you can't really kind of see it. But this kind of curved structure around here and this curved structure here, these two interlocking regions, that's the hippocampus. And it's just very regular and very beautiful. It's just an amazing thing to see on a microscopic section. And because in the rat it's quite large, you see it almost any cut that you make to the brain. So to understand what the neurons are doing in the hippocampus, you have to put a wire. So this is a representation of a physical wire. This is exactly what the wires look like that we put into the hippocampus. They're as fine as a hair, and we kind of twist them up to give them some rigidity and also to give us more recording opportunities. What we do is we anesthetize the animal, make a tiny little hole in the skull with a dental drill, and put one of these little wires, then lower it through the brain and into the hippocampus, and then seal that little hole in the skull, and then attach a little connector, and then let the animal recover for a few weeks or so. So now it's got this little kind of hat on its head, which rats don't seem to mind that. They don't seem to be puzzled by the fact that they now have a little hat on their head. But that then provides the possibility to connect that connector through a little recording wire to a computer and actually listen to what the neurons are saying. So what happens is that this wire that's sitting among these neurons is detecting the electrical activity of these neurons. So they're very, very tiny neurons. And the electrical pulses that they make are like, you know, a few tens of microvolts. They're really small. But that's enough to be able to detect with a wire and then amplify and then detect with a computer. And you can actually hear, if you feed the output through a loudspeaker, you can actually hear the neurons. And I'll play you one in a second. So people got very excited about the hippocampus because of HM. And one of the people who got excited about this is John O'Keefe, who at the time had just started his new lab in London. He was a young man at the time. And he'd come to University College, which is where I am, and he had decided to try and understand what the hippocampus was doing. And so he started applying this technique of putting microelectrodes into the brain. And he found this method of recording from freely moving animals. So up until that time, people had always done these experiments with anesthetized animals, so they weren't moving around, and it was very easy to record. They found that as soon as the animals moved around, it was very difficult to get stable recordings because the electrodes that neurophysiologists usually used were made of glass at that time, and glass is very rigid, and they found that the neurons, the moment the animal moved, the brain would move, and the neuron would impale itself on the glass electrode and stop firing. But O'Keefe developed these metal electrodes, and they're very flexible. So as the animal's walking around, the electrode just kind of wafts around with the neuron and follows it around. So actually, he found that he could not only record a neuron, but he could follow it as the animal was moving around for some number of hours or days, it turned out, or sometimes even weeks. And the record that's in the literature is 154 days. So it's an extraordinarily stable progression. So what he did was he would have the animal walking around on some kind of surface, usually just in a box or on a little platform or something like that. And he was collecting these nerve impulses, which looked like this on an oscilloscope screen. So this is just the trace that you would see. And if you pick off the spikes, which are the action potentials, the nerve impulses, then you can do things with those spikes. You can kind of do various types of analyses, like how fast is the neuron firing, and is it firing the regular way, or is it firing this and so on. And what he found was this very extraordinary thing that he noticed, which is that if you listen to where the cell is firing, you find that the action potentials all occur in one place in the environment. So every time the rat goes to that corner, this neuron would suddenly become really, really active, and every time it walks away again, it would fall silent. And it would walk around a bit, and it would be silent, and then it would come back to that corner, and suddenly it would start firing again. And if you record for maybe 10 minutes or so, you find that all of the action potentials from that one neuron are clustered in this one place in that box. And O'Keefe did this experiment a few times, and found that this was very reliable. So different cells would fire in different places, but each one had this kind of place that it liked to fire. So he called these cells place cells, and he proposed that these cells were forming a representation of where the animal was in the environment. So something like a mental map, if you like. So it was a bit of a controversial idea. And it wasn't really anything to do with memory, as far as anyone could tell. But it was a very, very interesting idea. People got kind of intrigued by it. So this is a real place cell. I'm hoping that this video will play its sound. So this is a rat in a box. So that machine gun sound is the nerve impulses. You can see them over here. And see how every time the rat goes to that little bit in the north of the box, it fires. And then everywhere else it's pretty silent. So just let it go once more. Notice that there's a couple of bits there as well. So that's a place cell. And place cells have turned out to be this incredible goldmine of information about how the mind works. That's what a place cell is. So based on this, O'Keefe and his colleague Lynn Nadell, who is a psychologist, they wrote this very, very controversial book called The Hippocampus as a Cognitive Map. So they proposed that hippocampus is making a map of space, and that map is used to organize memory. So like the method of loci, in a way, the brain has kind of come upon space as a really useful way to keep your memories organized and help you retrieve them again. So people sort of ran with this idea, but said, oh, okay, so if the hippocampus is involved in space, then we ought to be able to see some evidence that you need it for doing spatial things. And various experiments were done along the way, and hundreds of experiments. But one of the very, very influential experiments was done by Richard Morris, who was working in, so he started these experiments actually in St. Andrews, and then he moved his lab to Edinburgh. And he was my PhD supervisor. So when I got to Edinburgh in the early 90s, I worked with Richard Morris. And he had developed this method for measuring the spatial capabilities of rats. And it's called the water maze. That's usually called the Morris maze or the Morris water maze. And what it is it's a kind of a swimming pool for rats, but there's an escape platform hidden somewhere in the pool, and it's just below the surface so the rat can't see it or smell it, and they can't really tell where it is by any sensory means. And when you first put the rat in the pool, it swims around randomly, and then it bumps into the platform, climbs onto it, and kind of looks around and, you know, clearly kind of notices where it is, because the next time you put it back in the pool, it's much quicker to find the platform. And after about three or four times, whenever you put the rat back in the pool, it goes straight there. So it seems to have figured out where the platform is, even though it can't detect it directly. So to do that, it must have had to somehow figure out where it is in the pool based on the things that it can see in the room around it. So here's a sort of picture of a swimming rat. And what Morris found was that if you take a normal rat and take the platform away, if you put the rat in the pool, it'll swim round and round and round in the place where the platform was. So the platform was there where that little circle was. So this rat was hunting round and round and round trying to find the platform. So clearly it knew where it ought to be. However, if he found that if you make lesions or damage to the hippocampus, kind of similar to HM, and this is an experiment actually he did in collaboration with John O'Keefe, then you put the rat back in the pool and it just needs to search aimlessly. It's clearly searching. So clearly it remembers that there's a platform there somewhere, but it doesn't seem to know where it is. It seems to have just lost its ability to find its way around it. So all sorts of experiments since then have found similar findings. So practically any task of any kind that's got a spatial component will be affected by hippocampal damage. And that's also true for humans. And in fact, with humans, we've also got capacity not just to look at what happens when humans have hippocampal damage. And that's actually quite common. So if people have some traumatic event that deprives the brain of oxygen, the hippocampus is often the first thing to be damaged because it's so busy that it has a very high oxygen consumption. So there are quite a few people walking around with damaged hippocampi. And also, people with Alzheimer's disease are developing hippocampal damage as their very, very first thing that happens. So we have a large number of people with hippocampal damage. And every test of spatial navigation that we've come up with, they seem to be effective. Eleanor Maguire has done some pioneering work at the University College looking at not just at people with damage to the hippocampus, but also just looking at what parts of the brain, of the normal brain, are active when people do navigation tasks. And she published this really eye-catching set of studies of London taxi drivers. And she picked London taxi drivers because they spend all their long navigating. So they're navigating from door to dusk and they're very, very good at it. And she got these guys into the scanner, it's mostly guys, got them into the scanner and said, okay, either imagine that you're driving around, or Sony developed a virtual reality taxi driver game that involves driving around London. And so she got them to play this virtual reality game. And either way, she found that when they were having to think about the route from one place in London to a different place in London, then hippocampus would become very active. And with Hugo Spears, who was her student at the time, or postdoc rather, they showed that not only is the hippocampus active, but they showed when during the course of thinking about where they're going to go, exactly when that's active. So it's a really amazing set of studies. One she's really famous for is that she did some structural analyses of the brain of the taxi drivers, and she found that the ones who have been taxi driving for a long time actually developed an enlargement of the back part of the hippocampus, which is the part that in rats have been associated with navigation. So that's the part where if you make damage, then they can't solve the waterways task. So that in the taxi drivers, that part was enlarged. So the Evening Standard got hold of this finding, and they produced this really brilliant article with this picture of the table. The Canadians just thought this was fantastic, and they participated really happily in this ongoing set of studies. It's been amazing. And she won the Ig Nobel Prize for all this. So I don't know if anybody doesn't know what that is, but it's basically the counterpart of the Nobel Prize, and it's for a study that's first made people laugh and then makes them think. So the Ig Nobel Prize studies, they're genuine science. They're really genuinely good science. So that's her claim to that. O'Keefe, meanwhile, was becoming very famous for his study of place cells because place cells were becoming increasingly important, and we gradually began to realise how critical they were for our understanding of space. And he was a co-recipient of the 2014 Nobel Prize and stuff. So O'Keefe was my postdoc supervisor, actually. So I've been privileged to work with... Oh, and Hugo Spears is now one of my associates in the Institute for Behavioural Neuroscience that I manage. So I've worked with some of the really seminal figures in this field. It's been really an amazing journey for me. Okay, so we've got the hippocampus that seems to be important for spatial memory, but what about non-spatial memory, so memory in general? Because HM had not lost not just his ability to find his way around, but he'd forgotten everything, at least everything that you consciously can bring to mind. So in fact, there were certain things that he could learn. He could learn new motor skills, but he couldn't learn to remember things that happened to him. So we learned from him that there are at least two kinds of memory. One is sort of automatic motor memory, like learning to drive a car or so, and the other is more conscious memory where you have to call things to mind. And we call that type of memory episodic memory or declarative memory. And that's what was going on with him. And not just memory, so Eleanor Maguire also found that people with hippocampal damage also, that not only can they not remember things that have happened to them, but they can't even imagine possible things that might happen to them. So if you get people with hippocampal damage to imagine standing on a beach and to describe what they can see in their mind's eye, they can tell you what should be there. They can say, well, there's kind of sand behind the sea and so on, but they don't seem to be able to create it in any kind of spatial framework. So they can't say, well, I'm standing on the sand, in front of me is the sea, and over there there's the rock. You know, there's no spatial coherence to their imagination. So it's beginning to seem like the hippocampus is sort of the, like the sort of, I think of it as like a stage on which you kind of assemble the set of your memory, if you like. If you don't have that stage, you haven't got any way to assemble your set, and therefore you can't reconstruct your memory. Some people have talked about the mind palace, the kind of the creation that you construct in your mind that you use to organize your memory. So now we have this problem of how do we go about studying memory, given what I said earlier about the fact that it seems to be distributed throughout the brain. So in the 1990s, a few things came along that made it possible to ask questions that had never been askable before. And one of the really important discoveries was the sequencing of the genome. So this was a project that began way back when Watson and Crick, you know, proposed that DNA, or discovered that DNA is this double helix. So for those of you who don't know, I'm sure there's going to be people who know, but DNA is these two strands of molecules that are kind of twisted together. And the molecules have on them these things called base pairs. And base pairs come in four flavors. And the sequence of those base pairs is essentially the genetic code. So each strand has a sequence of base pairs, and the complementary strand has a kind of a complementary set of base pairs, and together they form what's essentially the genetic code. So there was this kind of hunt on that began right back in the 1950s. Really picked up speed in the 1990s when new methods came along to find out what was the actual ordering of these base pairs. So these four kinds, A, G, C, and T, you know, what was the order? And there are, you know, millions and millions and millions of these things. So it was a really, really big job. But in the 1990s, it became possible to automate this process and to do it in a hugely faster way than before. And so they started to find whole genome sequences. So in 1995, they first sequenced the influenza virus, which has 1.8 million base pairs. So even though it's a tiny little virus, that's quite a lot of stuff, you know, quite a lot of information packed in that tiny little bit. And then it exponentially increased. So 3 years later, they sequenced the first multicellular organism, C. elegans, which is a tiny little worm, which is amazingly, it's been amazingly useful to neurobiologists, because although it's just a tiny little worm, it does all sorts of things that are useful, like it moves in an organized way, and it can show, it can form memories, maybe not episodic memories like we do, but certainly simple kinds of memories and so on. So it's been a really good model organism for all sorts of fundamental biological processes. And then in 2002, they sequenced the mouse genome, and that's been really important because mice and rats are some of our favorite model organisms. And then in 2004, they declared the human genome sequence. Although, actually, it turns out there's the few things we still haven't figured out, but basically, most of it is pretty much there. So we now have the sequence, but the trick now is to find out what the sequence means. So knowing the sequence is not the same thing as knowing what it means. Just like knowing all the neurons in the brain will tell you how the brain works, we then have to decode this thing. But still, we've been able to decode quite a lot of it. So chunks of these base pairs form genes, and a lot of these genes are the code for the proteins, which then go on to form more cellular machinery and so on. So we've been able to identify huge numbers of genes, and that's given us incredible tools for asking some of the questions of memory. So in the 1990s, not only did we sequence the genome, but we figured out how to manipulate it. And we can do that in three main ways that are really useful to us. One of them, so you take your genes, so here's a kind of schematic of double-stranded DNA, and you've got a sequence of base pairs in here, which is your gene. So there are various things you can do. One of them is that you can take that gene out and you can put a different gene in. So you can, you know, for example, take out gene for brown eyes and put in the gene for blue eyes or something like that. You can just take gene out. So you can do what's called a knockout. So for example, you can knock out the gene that makes a certain kind of neurotransmitter receptor And they'd say, now what do the neurons do now that the animal's missing these receptors? Now, often when you do that, you end up with an organism that just won't survive because you've taken out something really critical for its life. So people have had to find ways of knocking out genes or indeed replacing genes in a way that that's much more restricted. And in the last sort of decade or two, it's been possible to target your manipulation, not to every cell in the body, but just to some cells, or even just to some cells at some times of the animal's life. So you can localize this effect in space and also in time. And that means that you can kind of reach in with these molecular forces and just tweak something. So for example, you can give an animal an injection of a drug that will temporarily silence the genes that make a certain kind of neurotransmitter receptor just in the hippocampus, for example. So now the animal is just missing that neurotransmitter in that part of the brain, but everything else is fine. And you see what it can't do, and then you let it come back on stream and go back to normal, and now you see what it can do, and so on and so on. So that's been a really, really amazing advance. And the other thing that you can do is just to add new genes. So you take the genes that are ordinarily there and you can add new ones. So using these methods, we've been able to do two things that have been really game-changing for neuroscience. So one of them is just help us see what's going on. So there's a whole bunch of organisms that are out there in the world that do something which humans can't do, which is that they have bioluminescence. So if you go on holiday to the Mediterranean or something like that, and you're walking on the beach in the evening, you see the sea look a bit luminous. It's absolutely beautiful. And or you go into a dodo cave. So in New Zealand, for example, we have dodo caves, which are really, really popular. And you see these just things all over the walls, these sparkling bright lights. That's bioluminescence, and it happens because there are genes in these organisms which are able to emit light when they're stimulated in particular ways. So after we sequenced those genes, people thought, well, hey, why don't we take some of these genes and stick them into animals that don't usually have them, like mammals? So they did that. And then the other, and I'll show you about that in a second, and then the other thing that we've been able to do is to take other kinds of genes, not just ones for fluorescence, but things for example, different kinds of receptor, and put them into neurons. So here's an example of putting fluorescence genes into animals. So this is a mouse that has, it's a baby mouse, that has one of these genes, green fluorescent protein, in every cell in its body. So when you shine a fluorescent light on that mouse, the whole thing glows green, which is, I think somebody may now be trying to market fluorescent pets for you or whatever. They're going to monetize it, for sure. But from a neurobiological point of view, it's not that useful, but it's kind of a proof of principle. But what is useful for neurobiologists is that we can now insert these genes into neurons, for example. And so when we now shine a fluorescent light on them, the neurons light up in a particular way, and you can see them. And the way that you can get these genes into these neurons, there are different ways. So you can actually do genetic engineering on the embryo, and so that the animal will have these genes in every cell of its body, like that green mouse that I just showed you. But the other thing that you can do is you can attach the gene to the genome of a virus. So, for example, an adenovirus or an influenza virus. And you can inject that virus into the brain so that it's modified so that it's not disease-causing to humans, usually, hopefully. But the virus, its job, like what viruses do, is they dig into cells and they attach themselves to the genome of the cell and they get that cell to start making more viruses. So if you hitch a gene to that virus, it'll also get into that cell and the cell will start making that gene as well. And so doing that, you can get only certain cells to express, for example, this green fluorescent protein. For example, you might want to light up only cells in the hippocampus or any pyramidal cells in the hippocampus or so on and so on. So that's been a really good way of being able to look at neurons. And I was using this method that we were able to get that really beautiful picture that I showed you earlier of the hippocampus, where the cells thin out. It's not just a green fluorescent protein, but there's also a yellow fluorescent protein and a red one and a blue one. And what they did was they had some process by which they would just randomly infect cells with one of these. They didn't control which cell got which. And so they ended up with just a whole bunch of multicolored cells. And that protein is expressed right throughout the cell, not just in the cell body, but also in the axon. So you can see, using these colors, you can kind of trace single axons right through. So this brainbow mouse has been really useful for anatomists, and also makes fantastic pictures for neuroscience tools. So that's a way, that's a very non-specific way of getting cells to light up with this fluorescent protein. More recently still, a group in the States, Fondalis group, actually is now in Japan, found a way to get cells to express green fluorescent protein only if they have been active. So this is a method called tagging, activity tagging. And the way it works is that when a neuron becomes really, really active, so let's say, for example, an animal is walking around and it goes into the place field of a place cell. The place cell suddenly becomes really, really active. That activity is associated with the switching on of some genes, and in particular, there's one gene called CFOS, which is just is part of basic housekeeping for that cell. But it's a really good marker for activity for that cell. When the CFOS gene switches on, you know that cell is active. So what they did was they found a way of getting green fluorescent protein only to be expressed in cells in which the CFOS gene had been turned on. So I won't go into the details of how they did that, but basically it's a way of lighting up only cells that were active. So by doing this, you can, for example, see which were all of the neurons in the hippocampus, which were place cells for this particular place. So this way of activity tagging neurons is very, very important because remember I said that memory is distributed throughout the brain, and that makes it really, really difficult to study. So now we have a method for looking at which cells in a cell assembly were active. You can just see which are the ones that are lighting up green when you shine fluorescent light on them. They were the cell assembly for that particular experience. So reporting on active cells has been one really important function that's been given to us by molecular biology. The other one is you can actually change the function of neurons by inserting new genes. And the way that this has been employed to incredible effect in the last 10 years is to exploit a property that some organisms have that is to be light sensitive. So most of the cells in our bodies aren't light sensitive because they're encased in skin and bone and light never really gets in. But there are quite a lot of organisms who are really simple and they don't have much tissue. And they're essentially transparent, so light will penetrate light through. And blue-green algae is an example. And these have lots of genes that are actually switched on by light. And the way that happens is that the light activates a receptor in the cell membrane, and the receptor gets off in ions and so on, and then that triggers the chemical process to turn on the genes. So many of the biologists said, well, why don't we take this gene for light sensitivity that's in these blue-green algae and stick them into a mammal? You know, we've done it with green fluorescent protein, why can't we do it with this one? And you think, well, why would you do that? Because, you know, there's no light inside the body anyway. So, but what happens when you do this is that you make these cells potentially sensitive to light. So you can stick them in a mouse, and you can make the cells in that mouse potentially sensitive to light, and then you can shine a light into that mouse in an optic fiber. So this is a really creatively clever idea, but here's an example of a rat actually. That's got an optic fiber. So whereas we would normally use a wire recording cable, this mouse rat has an optic fiber going into its brain. And when you shine a light down that optic fiber, it will activate the light-sensitive proteins and membranes of those cells of that transfected animal or whatever. And the membranes, proteins will change their shape and let the ions flow in, and that will activate the cell, as if an action potential had activated the cell. So from the point of view of the neuron, it doesn't know whether it was another neuron that stimulated it or whether it was light that stimulated it. All it knows is that all of these ions come flooding into the cell. So this is a method called optogenetics. So basically you've used genetics to make these cells light sensitive, such that when you shine light on them, they become active. Now how can you use this to study memory? So what you can do is couple this with activity tagging. And I don't know how many of you are still with me, because this is kind of complicated. But I'm just going to tell you this last, putting all of this together, which I think is one of the most amazing developments of my lifetime. So what you can do is you can create a new memory in an animal that's had this optogenetic manipulation. So in fact, this is exactly what Tanigawa did. He took a mouse and he gave it an experience. And what he did was he gave it an unpleasant experience. And that activates the hippocampus, because the hippocampus is the thing which becomes active when you go into a place and you have an experience. And that activated all of these place cells, and because the place cells were all activated, that turned on CFOS. And because the CFOS was activated, that turned on the fluorescent protein and said, not the fluorescent protein, the light-sensitive protein. So he'd attached the light-sensitive protein to the CFOS gene so that only the cells on which CFOS was turned on would express this light-sensitive protein. So only those ones would be light-sensitive. Are you with me? So when you shine a light into that mouse, only the cells that had been activated by that experience would respond to that light. So then that's what he did. He took the mouse, he put it into another environment where nothing bad had ever happened. And with some of the mice, he just didn't do anything. And those mice just didn't do anything either. They kind of wandered around and did mousy things. But they weren't bothered about that because they didn't have any reason to be afraid. But some of the mice, he shone the light down that optic fiber, and those mice froze in fear. Now the reason, and he did various kind of control experiments to rule out some of the other possibilities, but the reason, and it's a pretty compelling argument, is that when he shone that light on those mice, that activated those neurons that had been activated by a fearful experience and reminded the mouse of that fearful experience. And you know, maybe the mouse thought, oh my God, I'm in that horrible place again. Now, we don't exactly know what's going on in the mind of the mouse, but we do know that the mice froze in fear. You could shine the light on a mouse that hadn't had a bad experience, it didn't shine in fear. You could shine a yellow light down that fiber, which doesn't activate those proteins. Those mice didn't freeze in fear. Only the ones with the light would activate those cells, froze. So the inescapable conclusion is that the cell assembly for that experience had been reactivated by the light. So these scientists have been able to manipulate, reach into the brain essentially, and manipulate that memory. So that's led on to a whole bunch of even more cool experiments. So what they've done, for example, is they've been able to take a mouse, make it afraid of the place, take it, give it some experiences together with the activation of those cells by light that make it unafraid of that place, and then put it back to the original place, and the mouse is no longer afraid. And so on and so on. So in other words, they've been able to edit the memory after the event. So this is such amazing science fiction type of stuff. There's this, not only are we looking into the brain and seeing these memories, but we're manipulating them afterwards. And you know, it opens up all sorts of weird, wonderful possibilities, but it opens up all sorts of therapeutic possibilities as well, because it gives us, for example, the ability to imagine being able to edit somebody's extreme traumatic experiences to make them slightly less traumatic so that they can deal with it and so on. But just from an experimental point of view, from a research point of view, it's given us this tool to understand how memories are stored and where they're stored, which bits are stored where and so on, that we just could only have dreamed about back in the last century. So it's been a really exciting development, and I feel very privileged to have seen it come on stream, and I can't wait to see what happens in the next session. So I'm going to, this is a picture of what they did. So I'm going to just leave it there. Thank you for your attention. I've given you a lot of information, and I hope that you've rationalised it too fast. So I'm very happy to take questions and sort of talk about what it's in.